improvements will continue to take place as we move forward to ensure the service continues to comply with the development best practice standards and adapt to the changing nature of the public service. Officers are requested to consider the note of the board. I apologise for the sheer volume and size of it, but I wanted it to be as comprehensive as it was possible. It does cover a 12-month period and does follow a best practice template, which is fairly widely used across the year. Happy to take any questions.
Thank you. My question was around relating to page 51 and 52, which was around when you identified, you know, that you've got the policies and procedures in place, it's part of compliance, and about it being an Article 2 now. That's been identified as an issue, and you said that senior management have acknowledged it and are taking the necessary steps. I just wanted to know that is there monitoring in terms of particular service areas, but what I would, you know, like to know is I want it to be identified if there's an ongoing issue in particular departments or way particular people manage. So I was just looking for some comment on that. Thank you.
There is clearly an underlying issue there, an issue which we have discussed at this committee on a number of occasions throughout the year. Action have been taken by senior management. There is also a subgroup of the public image group being formed to look specifically at compliance per se across the organisation. That subgroup, like I said, chaired by the Secretary of Finance Officer, Director of Finance and Investment, is active as we speak, is looking to identify exactly where there are quite specific areas of non-compliance in regards to what, with a view to more detailed reports going back to SLT and fairly robust actions being taken in response to those reports. So it's very much a work in progress, but it's very much a more proactive piece of work that we've seen in the past.
I think that kind of drilling down is essential, really. And you know, it's looking, isn't it? It's a training issue, somebody couldn't realise, or a competency issue, or that's reassuring to know it's kind of drilled down. Thank you.
And I will
look
back to you with further questions.
Yeah, again, there's a couple of things I couldn't raise here, but I think I'll raise it very carefully as the auditors. But one of the key elements I think is missing from the terms of the insurance statement is around our transformation programme. Now, I'm going to be doubly consistent around that, where we were told 2 years ago. It was going to save £40 million in 2 years, other than some people say more than that. So, given, I think, when it comes to office, as we've sorted more offices, what I'm not seeing is, given its criticality to the sustainability of the budget, to such an extent it was in the letter that the leader wrote to the Secretary of State when he asked for his deal, his financial deal. Not to see it here at all, to have any commentary around it about whether it is delivering benefits, whether it's on track, all that sort of stuff. And just what the government's arrangements are now, and the change in cabinet's responsibilities. So, who, what, how, when are we going to actually see some sort of report around the governance around that? And the other, I suppose, ended on the 31st of March, so the Director of Finance and Investment, Section 151 Officer, only made her feelings clear on this later on in May about the calls to the budget to look at discretionary spending to see if it's being spent in the right areas. I don't know what the formal words are, it's a bit of agreement between and the 151 Officer. But that would would suggest we did not, we just went through a revision process that finished in the beginning of March. So that happened to implement that in sort of middle of May or the end of May. So we don't think it's a good discussion. We suggest there might be a bit of a problem with the budget making process. And, you know, in terms of value for money, in terms of, like you mentioned, it's quite reckless of everything I feel mistaken. So that's just a bit of an area of concern in terms of how are we sure that, you know, we're all doing the right things and other issues here that we need to look into.
I think you just need to maybe share with us what the system is.
Thank you, Chair. I'll pick those the first two points up. So on the transformation funding, there is a paper on the agenda on the NTPS needed to implement the strategy, where we could actually reset the old strategy. So that 3-year plan, the transformation funding, the 40 million and 30, I've gone back and looked at that with the transformation team, who really submitted the original plans. Actually reset that. Some of that will be delivered in a way that is originally due to be delivered. And it's quite a comprehensive process we just need to go through to find out why that is. Obviously things change. Once we set the NDFS, it's never set in stone because lots of different things change during the year. And we have to keep resetting that. So to keep it sort of as it was, I think as it is, so we need to make sure that we're updating it. New things that come on board at the time. So there has been a resetting of that, and that has been built into the new MTS process, which I'll talk about later on, and that comes on the agenda. Just to pick up the second point about the review of the spending, there isn't a spending it's not related to the fact that we are not able to have this budget. So you're quite right, the budget was set in March for 2018-19. The first quarter report has just been through Cabinet now. That's presenting that we are overspending a little bit, £678,000 on the £1 million budget. That's the forecast for the year. Forecast for the year out. We have got mitigations in place to mitigate that spend. But from my perspective, I wanted to be prudent, to be open and honest with Cabinet really to say we do have some issues, I want to relate to those as soon as I possibly can, but we have got plans in place to mitigate that. In terms of the review of the spend, so from the 1st of June, to be quite right, I set up some new processes really to review all non-essential spend and also all vacancies. From my own perspective, again, ensure that I have to provide the assurance to the committee that money we're spending, because the resources are within the rural research budget, and we did use a lot of our reserves for our 18-19 budget, that's not sustainable going forward. I needed to make sure and to provide assurance to myself that everything we were spending was within the rural plan, so we were actually spending on the things that we said we would spend on. There was no things there that didn't relate to beneficial outcomes. So we haven't got a free, we've got a spending panel. So each of those two panels, one for agency, one for expenditure, two separate people on each of those different panels. People will submit a request for spending to be analysed, if you like, and the panel will analyse that, have a look at it, find if it is within the things we spoke to them. We haven't rejected any of those expenditure. So we haven't said we can't spend because people have budgets. We rely on trust budget managers, senior leadership to manage their budgets themselves effectively. So we're not saying we mustn't spend anything. What we have found is some areas of best practice. So where we've had some items that have been commissioned from different suppliers, the commissioning team have been able to provide some advice to different budget holders to say, actually, if we had a contract for these different and also there's going to be areas where we've asked officers to go back and provide some more information. So where they provided some requests to spend in having to go back and explain what the return on that investment is, what the time of that investment will be, just to make sure that if we are reducing some spending for investment, there is a sufficient payback, and we have got a plan in place to realise the benefits. So it's not a freeze, it's a panel. As I say, we haven't rejected any spend, but we have found quite a lot of elements of best practice where we can generate some efficiencies.
I'm sure Philip will have a very simple explanation about why that doesn't constitute the budget and policy framework, which I'm using as a council responsibility as opposed to candidate responsibility, because the budgets were set with all the various departments having agreed on that basis. So that will be interesting. The other point there, this is being made persistent, because I talked about this from the word Jen and Andrew at least ago, the back of the comments. All right, when that transformation programme was set up, I was told it was going to save 40 million quid. And I was also told it will save more than 40 million pounds. And it had a significant amount of cash attached to it to make that programme run. So if what you're now saying is you'll constantly be baselining it, my question would be, given the importance of that sort of that programme, I did warn people that it wasn't proper governance, it would be unlikely to deliver, so I don't know what you'd be baselining to be able to tell us. But I do think, again, given the importance of it, somebody should get some this committee, I imagine, should get some sort of assurance about how that programme is spending its money, how it's being assured in terms of its risks being managed and mitigated, and it's delivering its benefits. Again, this was one of the reasons why we weren't going to have to use more of expenditure, was because the transformation programme is going to deliver year-on-year savings. So, as I say, it appears to have dropped out of all the cabinet level responsibilities. I'm not clear how that's being governed now. So it would be, I think it's an area of concern. As I said, given its importance, I'm surprised it's not referenced in this, the annual report in terms of key issues that we need to be assured of ourselves.
No,
I'm
sure.
Yeah, I just come back to that, actually. So of that, I mean, the 40 million referred to, just to kind of just remind members, it was it's a 37.8 million programme over 3 years.
Well, that might have been rebased by then, because, last year.
Oh.
And when she was doing the job, you were doing the job. But Michael, if I ask all these questions, ask questions in council, ask questions here, I was told 40 million. And we believe that we can deliver a lot more. If you remember, we brought in a special director to do it, but that would have been a lot of actual built to be able to do it. So, to now say it's 38.5, and as a cabinet member, it's very clear it's beyond 38.5 and over 40 million.
Yes,
that's
a
very
good
integration, which is due to deliver over the 3 years, that is fully on.
potential work with those who are anticipated. So some of, most of the majority of that 40 million are still in line to be delivered.
Yes.
Thank you, Chair. Forgive me, my questions are a bit. I'd just like to ask, the one-off sums of money that come in from sales of buildings and pieces of land and stuff, how does that figure in budget figures? Is that shoring up some budget? Although it's not revenue, it's capital. But there are, how does that figure in that, those plans? Is it going to be supported by solid land?
So, for the 18-19 budget, there was 10 million one-off funding as a result of capital receipts. The government enabled us to use capital receipts for revenue funding, as long as we can demonstrate that it's transforming the service, doing something significantly differently, and generating future efficiencies. So, we have got £10 million in the 18-19 budget one-off funding. We have got a list of areas, buildings, land assets that we are planning to sell to meet that 10 million. It was actually a 3-year programme and we are forecasting a very small surplus on that 10 million on that loan. The whole capital receipts are a 3-year programme, so we are anticipating we will get all those assets in as well. We are not forecasting any one-off fundings from 1920. So 1819 is the last year we're anticipating to be able to.
Is there a contingency plan for those projects that go on over 3 years if they're on our payments don't come in for sales for those projects?
So the whole of that, so the government has said we can actually have a 3-year plan to generate those receipts. We anticipate that we're going to spend all the money in this year, 2014. We are allowed to generate those receipts up to 3 years to pay that back, if you like. So after this year, so after 18-19, we don't anticipate spending any more on those capital receipts. We have got a plan for those receipts. We do a monitoring report every month and go to SRT. We have got a plan to make sure those receipts will be realised and we will be able to use them to sort of pay back the money we spent this year. We do monitor that quite closely because we need to see the risk.
I just want to bring Mark back in first, and then we can do it.
So that's the issue of council being raised earlier regarding the transmission project and the risk associated with having insurance on it. Within the report of page 69, you may have noticed there's a specific piece of work on the access road to the transmission project, which we did a quite detailed piece of work on that, and now it's now with very significant sort of action points for in here, imagine how to address those issues. There were other targeted pieces of work in the technical work transfer intervention, how we have more work to get in within 18-19, to look at specific some of the risks associated with some of the work. Missing it, it is an overall kind of management transition.
And it's actually a share of the rulings. If in 2016 we set up a 3-year programme to deliver 40 million, I'm not sure how that programme goes to 2021, sure, because that seems more than 3 years. And if we rebaseline the programme in terms of whether the benefits are going to be delivered, that's a bit of a concern. So we've done the capitalisation in the letter that we asked to do this, but we've actually pushed back on the and the savings are going to be the benefits are going to be realised. That's a bit of a concern. So I would like, I think we should, certainly in terms of risk, have some assurance about what is going on with that programme, how much is expected, where it's going to deliver the benefits, etc. Beyond being put into the medium term financial plan as a line somewhere, because I think there should be some more formal going to actually change the time, cost and quality of these big transformational projects. remains a bit of concern for me, in terms of how that's going forward. So I do hope that that's that we take the wider look at what's happening to that program.
Yes, do you want to come back? No, I'm happy. Everyone happy now? Yes, sir. So can I ask you to note that, and I should have asked you to note the previous one as well, as Phil has just reminded me.
I'll head to both, but subject to the look at that. I'm not planning for about the assurance relations for the programme. What on earth the programme is this? What it's going to deliver is my point.
Of course, share your comments.
Yeah, I mean, we'll certainly do that anyway. It's part of our business. The 37.8 million for the relaying was done in February 17, which is probably why some of those dates that we passed out remember. So it's part of the NTFS resetting process, which was done in February 17. I will be going to the back to cabinet this December, so I can certainly bring something back to the committee to give you the assurance that we are delivering that program.
So I would like some assurance that it's being managed properly, spending money on the property to become the right benefits. Rebased on exceptions and allowances. Benefit delayed is a benefit.
Okay, Jen, I think you made a point there.
Thank you. This is the link.
So we can now have that report on board. Next one. Six. We do have a forward on item 6, we have put that. It's a forward with a few words from me, and I think the most significant of the words from me are in the final paragraph, followed by acknowledging the skill and work of this committee and the officers who support this committee.
Can I just give a factual correction?
The factual correction?
Yeah, okay. I was just starting point. I was in space and watching. Well, I'm sure the public will be great to learn from the world, but in terms of...
I'm sure.
Yeah, just a factual correction.
This is actually a best practice requirement for the meeting to be handled and brought to the cabinet of the way on the 10th of this year. Factual inaccuracy will be to the side, as we've got said the best one. The report introduces the report prepared by the chair and includes it itself. We ask to approve it before we conduct the announcing of the available.
Because all the risk management stuff I'm doing about due diligence, it's tending to be workshopping in terms of, you know, like the early impact, is that right? Obviously, I need to find the risk properly. All that really dull, well, for some people it's dull, for us we can't trust it. So can we make a kind of suggestion to the council about going into some of this in more detail? Is there something we can do within this process of engaging this committee in some sort of workshop or arrangement about thinking through what the key risks are and how effective our current mitigation?
I think it's a really sensible proposal.
Don't sound surprised, Mike.
No,
it's
all I do.
So, just, you know, I'm
Yeah, I just wanted to get over that. Some while ago, there was a bit of a discussion about IT and redundancy and moving from one building to the other, two buildings and how we're going to help. You just mentioned business continuity rules, but has that been achieved then? Because I think it was last year, the year before, that was supposed to have been done and completed paper-based wise or desktop acquisition. Has that been completed now? Is it satisfactory?
Yes, it has. And you're quite right, there were some delays, and it was reported to the committee, and there's nothing happening that legislation on that. We now have a position where we do a lot of work, very effective work from Birmingham, we've got a colleague to do that, and Mr. Durbin was chairing that group at the time, based on the completion of these plans. He's going to sit through now, have a conflict at that point, and then we're going to cross the gap, and we're going to test the way it has been.
You realise what the issue about posting continuities on the web is, don't you? So what you do when the web goes down? So yeah, it's on the IT. It's the IT that's gone down. So we might need to think about it.
Chris,
yeah.
Sorry, did you say you've been testing as well?
Yes.
With regards to the internet, source of supporting accounts, which more widely has become more efficient now.
services, thus offering insurance to any school, academy or otherwise, must be an opportunity for, we must be providing the value for money in terms of the way we provide insurance. So, you know, are we selling it properly? You know, this has the potential to move from what's been a constant boom and benefit to give it to actually a bit of a cost if we can't self-insure everything.
In terms of the kind of